Lord today, we're not going to be talking about love. We're going to be talking about nature. And Father, I'm going to pray that you would help us to be receptive to your word this morning, that it might find fertile soil in which to land, that it'll bear fruit, more fruit than much fruit. Lord, not as we speak about love, but as we speak about hatred. And Father, may we understand as parents, as grandparents, the great responsibility that we have to teach our children, to teach our grandchildren, for us to believe that there is a line that we as Christians cannot cross. And because of our love for Jesus, the world is going to hate us. Oh God, may we choose to be popular with you and not popular with the world. God, today, find fertile soil, I pray, in our hearts. Heal our friend and our brother Jason, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we say amen, church family?
Amen.
All right. Now, I want to continue our series, Love Letters from the Groom to the Bride. Today, I'm going to speak to you specifically, about why the world hates Jesus and why the world hates you. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, the Bible says that the world hates you. Our text today is John chapter 15, verses 18 to 25. And we know from John chapter 14 that Jesus has finished the last supper with the disciples. He's washed their feet. He's talked to them about the Holy Spirit. And now Jesus says to the remaining 11 disciples, "Come now, let us leave." And so Jesus and the disciples get up. And as they're walking out of that upper room, whether they're going to another room, I don't know. But I personally think that they are probably have left the upper room, gone down the steps, and are making their way across the city of Jerusalem to the Garden of Gethsemane. They are under the full moon of the Passover sky. The timing is probably somewhere around midnight or after midnight. It's been a long day, and so they're all tired. And Jesus, as they're walking out of the upper room, probably looks out, and there's a vine, because vineyards are all over Israel. And under the full moon, he sees a vine, and he says to the disciples, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener or the husbandman." And then he talks about the vine and the care of the vine. And he says, "My Father, the vine dresser, the gardener, the husbandman, he takes care of the vine, the branches, you and me as believers." And what does he do to us believers? Well, he lifts us up. Later this year, we're going to have vines growing in our prayer garden. And we're going to know what it means to lift them up. We're going to learn what it means to prune them, because that's what the Father does to you and to me as Christians. And he tells us our purpose. So many people wandering aimlessly through life. What am I supposed to do? Well, the Bible tells us what is the purpose of the Christian. John chapter 15, verse 8. Here's what he says. "Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit." That's God's purpose for you and for me. That we bear fruit and bring glory to Him. So having said all of that, as they're walking down the steps of the upper room, as they're making their way across Jerusalem, Jesus, having spoken to them 13 times about love, He turns the story. Walking towards Gethsemane, He changes the subject. Instead of speaking about love, He now speaks about hate. Here's what He says in John chapter 15, verse 18. "If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. And that is why the world hates you. And the first thing I wanted to talk about this morning is I wanted to define the world. What does he mean by the world? Does God hate grass? Does God hate trees? Does God hate water? No. But if you were to take your Bibles, and I would urge you to do this, if you were to take your Bibles and turn to 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 to 17, here's what you would read. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever. If you were to read that passage of Scripture and meditate upon it and think upon it, you would discover that what God says is this. We actually live in this world system in which there are actually two ways to define love. There's God's love, and then there's the world's love. There are two goals or two aspirations. There's that which is from God. There's that which is from the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. There is that which is eternal, and there is that which is temporal and now. And when you and I think of the world, we think of that world system that has an opposite definition of love, an opposite definition of fulfilling goals and desires. Has an opposite definition. Because it wants us to fulfill ourselves now. It's about here, it's about now. And God's love is eternal. And so Jesus is saying to the disciples, and to you and to me, there's a world system that's very different than from my kingdom. He tells us in 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, how great is the love that the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. So why is there a world system out there? Is it because it doesn't know about God? No. We know from our study of Romans 1, 19 and 20 that everybody knows about God. We know that there must be a God. But knowing about God and knowing God personally is two different things. And so the world system doesn't know God personally. So we come then to a great passage. John chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. You remember what God did? God did something wonderful for you. He did something wonderful for me. For God so loved the world that He gave His own one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. So the Holy Spirit comes into this world system. And He knocks on hearts' doors. He said, I've come to redeem you. I've come to pay the penalty for your sins. My Father loves you so much, He sent me to come to this world and die on the cross for your sins. Would you let me come into your heart as your Lord and your Master and your Savior? And while those of us who are Christians have said yes to Jesus, the Bible goes on in John 3, 18 to 19 to say this. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. So the Holy Spirit comes to those in the world system. And He says, God has sent His Son to die on the cross for your sins, to redeem you of your sins. But what do many in that world system do? They like their sins. They like their sinful life. They enjoy sin because the Bible says there's pleasure in sin for a season. So instead of turning to the light of Jesus, they reject the light. And they reject God's Son. So we have two different worlds. God's world, the born-again believers in Jesus Christ, the church of God, and then we have the world system over here. If you go back to our text, what the Bible says is this. If the world, that world system, hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world system, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world system, but I have chosen you out of the world system. That is why the world system hates you. So what God has done, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross for your sins and mine, to redeem us. He sends His Holy Spirit, who knocks on your heart door. Maybe He knocked on your heart door at Vacation Bible School. Mine was at a summer camp in the middle of Pennsylvania when I was 9 years old. And He knocks on your heart's door, and He says, I'm the Savior. You're a sinner. I've come to redeem you. Will you say yes to me? And what happens is, He is calling us out of the world. That's what we mean by separation. The world, the word chosen in verse 16 and 19 is the Greek verb ek legio, ek meaning out, and legio to call. He's calling us out of the world system, out of the world system, to be a part of His church, to be a part of the body of Christ, to be those believers in Jesus Christ. That's what He's calling us to do. So now, if you are a part of the body of Christ, if you are a Christian, if you have been chosen, if you've been called out of that world system, Jesus, on His way to Gethsemane, under the full moon of the Passover sky, sometime after midnight, walking through the streets of Jerusalem, He begins to talk to His disciples, not about love, but He talks about hate. And He gives us four reasons why those in the world system hate you and hate me and hate Jesus. Do you want to know why the world system hates us? Here's the answer. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world system, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world system. But I have chosen you, called you out of the world system. That is why the world system hates you. First of all, it hates you because you and I, as Christians, are different. We are different. We have a different authority, the Bible. We have a different master, Jesus. We are different individuals. If you were to take your Bible and go to Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1, here's what it says. Therefore, holy brothers, separated brothers, who share in the heavenly calling, who've been called by God. Therefore, holy brothers, who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, the apostle and high priest. Our thoughts are focused on Jesus, not on the world system, not on the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Why does the world hate you and me as believers in Jesus Christ? Simply because we're different. You probably don't know the name of Jonas Hanaway. I'm not sure if he's related to Jerry or Patty or not. But Jonas Hanaway was a different man. He was a hated man. You know why Jonas Hanaway was hated? Because he was different. He created, invented, what we call the umbrella. The umbrella. He would walk down the streets of England with an umbrella. Nobody had an umbrella except Jonas Hanaway. So what did people do when he walked down the streets of London? They threw rocks at him. They threw dirt at him. Why? Because he was different. They hated him because he was different. And the world hates us because we're different. There's another reason the world hates us. Because of our identification. Look at verse 20. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. Remember when we looked at 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 18, and then we looked at 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, the Bible says that the world system does not know God. They know about Him, but they don't know Him personally. You know Him personally. Because you know God personally. Because you know Jesus personally. Because Jesus went to the cross for you. Because He died on the cross for your sin. Because He called you out of the world system. You love Jesus. And you're identified with Jesus. Sometimes that's hard, isn't it? You would take your Bibles and go back to John chapter 13, verse 1. When we first began our series, here's what we read. It was just before the Passover feast, Thursday evening. Jesus knew that the time had come for Him to leave this world. Jesus was going to Calvary. He's going to die. He's going to leave the world. Having loved His own who are in the world, Jesus is leaving, but He's left us here. You and I are in the world. So what did He say to His disciples who were left in the world? He said to them that evening, John chapter 13, verse 15, I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth. No servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Jesus said, I'm giving you the example. Follow me, follow me. What happens when we follow Jesus? What happens when we identify with Him? What happens when we do what He did? Well, the Bible tells us. If they hated me, they'll hate you. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. Remember fearful Timothy? Paul told fearful Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Identify with Jesus, and what do you get? Persecution. Can I tell you something? One thing that Jesus never does, He never glosses over the cost of discipleship. Jesus tells us right up front, if you love me, if you identify with me, you are going to be hated and persecuted. Aren't you grateful that Jesus tells you everything up front? There's a third reason the world will hate you. Because the Bible says, verse 22. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. Say that with me, guilty of sin. Say it with me. Guilty of sin. Say it again. Guilty of sin. Listen. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. Now, however, they have no excuse for their sin. He who hates me hates my Father as well. If I had not done among them what no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen these miracles, and yet they have hated both me and my Father. Jesus is talking now about the difference between righteousness and religion. When Jesus came to this earth, He came to the Jews, and they were steeped in religion, right? The Old Testament religion. And Jesus did something. The Bible says, if I had not spoken to them, Jesus gave us the words. He said, if I had not done for them the things that I had not done, He gave us His works. The words of Jesus and the works of Jesus proved that Jesus was indeed the Son of God. And as Jesus spoke, and as Jesus proved Himself, He continually pointed out that the problem with humanity was sin, and that there was one solution to sin, and that is the Savior who dies on the cross for our sins. And that is why the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, He made Him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be the righteousness of God, to be sin, so that I might be made the righteousness of God. Jesus took my sin and died for it, so that I might be clothed and covered in His righteousness. But the Jews didn't want to hear that, did they? Shake your head no. They did not want to hear that. They were very comfortable in their religion. To show you just how comfortable they are in their religion, I'll invite you to take your Bibles and turn back just a few pages to John chapter 9. In John chapter 9, there's a man who was born blind. And the disciples said, "Who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus said, "Nobody sinned. He was born blind in order that the works of God might be seen." In other words, that I could come along as the Son of God and heal him of his blindness. And I could prove to all of the world that I am indeed the Son of God. Because, quite frankly, nobody else does works like this. Was Jesus readily accepted by the Jews? Did they embrace him? John chapter 9, verse 13. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. The day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed, and now I see." And some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God. He doesn't keep the Sabbath." You know what religion does? Religion says, "I am better than Jesus. He may be healed a blind man, but I keep the Sabbath." Religion is better than Jesus. But now listen. Religion is not only better than Jesus. Religion is better than the man who was born blind and healed. Because if you look at John chapter 9, verse 34, "To this day," that is, the Pharisees replied, "You were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us?" The Pharisees, the religious crowd, they weren't only better than Jesus. Why, they were better than the man who was born blind and healed. He was steeped in sin. You can see them looking down on him, can't you? And isn't that what religion does? Religion sees itself as better than anybody else. Better than God, better than Jesus, and certainly better than that man steeped in sin. That's what religion is. That's why Jesus didn't call us to religion. And that's why I don't call you to be a Baptist or a Methodist or a Presbyterian. We call you to be a Christian. What was the problem? The problem was sin. And Jesus was speaking about righteousness. What is righteousness? He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Righteousness means I'm not clothed in religion. I'm clothed in Christ. I'm not a Baptist, I'm a Christian. I'm not a Methodist, I'm a Christian. I'm not an Episcopalian, I'm a Christian. That's righteousness. Did the religious crowd love Jesus and embrace him? Sort of not. If you look at John chapter 9, verse 29, they hurled insults at the man born blind. They insulted him. Guess what? Stand for Jesus. You might get insulted. You might have insults hurled at you. Look at verse 34. "To this they replied, 'You're steeped in sin of birth. How dare you lecture us?' And they threw him out. They threw him out of the synagogue." Persecution. Persecution comes from those who are religious, not those who are righteous. When he was thrown out, the man born blind, I want you to see what Jesus did for him. Verse 35. Jesus heard that they threw him out and he found him. How cool is that? Jesus went looking for him. He found him. If you're a Christian, Jesus found you, didn't he? He found me in Pennsylvania. All places to be found. In the camp. North of the Mason-Dixon. Oh, my goodness. Found me. Aren't you glad that we have a seeking Savior? Jesus heard they did thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? The Son of Man, it's a term found all the way back in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 13. It means the Messiah. Do you believe in the Messiah? Do you believe in the Christ? Who is he, sir? Tell me, and I'll believe. Jesus said, you've now seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking with you. The man said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. He bowed down and he worshiped him. That's what righteousness does. Righteousness says the problem is sin, and Christ is the answer. He took my sin, and I'll be clothed in his righteousness. You bow down and you worship him. So I would ask you, is there a point in time in your life, not when you became a Baptist, or a Methodist, or a Presbyterian, or Episcopalian? Is there a time when you came face to face with the fact that you were a sinner and you needed a Savior? And you didn't come to the church and get baptized. You went to Christ at the Calvary. He said, I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. You became wrapped in his righteousness. Is there that time in your life? And if not, I will meet you here at the altar in about 10 minutes or less. There's a fourth reason why the world hates Jesus and you. That's what he says in verse 25. But this is to fulfill what is written in the law. They hated me without reason. Jesus is quoting Psalm 69:4. Jesus knew the Bible. He had already quoted Psalm 41:9 in relationship to Judas. Jesus knew the Bible. And Jesus taught the Bible. Early on in their relationship, what we've come to know as the Beatitudes, Jesus said something to the disciples and to you and to me. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of religion? No. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. We're identified with Jesus. Rejoice and be glad. Because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who went before you. The world hates you and me and Jesus because of the Bible. The Bible is our authority. And so we go out and we teach the Bible. We quote the Bible. We live the Bible. Jesus said in John 14:23, if anyone loves me, he obeys my word. It's the Bible, right? Thanks, Marshall. Thanks, Mr. Thompson. Let's try it one more time. We obey the Bible, right? So you walk out of here, believing the Bible, having been taught the Bible. Somebody confronts you about our crosses out front. And you say, the Bible teaches that abortion is murder. You don't say it's a woman's right. You say it's murder. And you know what happens? You're hated because of it. You walk out of here and you teach the Bible. You quote the Bible. You mention it at work. Somebody speaks to you about gay rights. And you say, well, the Bible calls that sin. What do? They hate you. They persecute you. Why? Because of the Bible. Jesus has said to his disciples, under the full moon of the Passover sky, sometime around midnight, or afterwards, He's talked to them about love 13 times. He knows that the Garden of Gethsemane is near. He knows that his arrest, his trial, his crucifixion is near. He knows that later this day, he's going to be taken off of the cross and put in the tomb, and they're not going to know what to do. And he says, I want to prepare you. If you belong to me, if you live a different life, if you identify with me, if you choose righteousness over religion, if you believe the Bible, teach the Bible, live the Bible, you are not going to be loved. You're going to be hated. And Jesus was up front with the disciples, with you and with me. So I wanted to tell you today, I wanted to tell you why we need Saturday prayers for Sunday power. I wanted to tell you why we need pulpit prayers. One of the reasons we need pulpit prayers and Saturday prayers for Sunday power is because if you stand with Jesus, if you're different because of Jesus, if you live the Bible and you choose righteousness over religion, you're going to be hated out there. And you need to be able to come in here and find the love of God and the presence of God and the peace of God. And that's why I beg of you to become a Saturday prayer for Sunday power. I beg of you to become a pulpit prayer. Why? Because when you come out of the world and you've had a week in which you've been hated or persecuted and talked about, insulted, what you need here is to feel, to experience the presence of God. And that comes as Christians gather together in prayer. That'll come if you pray on Saturday. It'll come if we have a pulpit prayer. But there's another reason. The Bible says, and even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light and glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. The Bible teaches us that Satan has blinded the eyes of unbelievers. How else do you account for the Pharisees seeing a man born blind and healed? And then say, no, he didn't keep the Sabbath. How else can you account for that except the supernatural blindness that comes from Satan? And what I'm saying to you is this. If you have a relative in the world system, if you have a friend in the world system, if you have a neighbor in the world system, the only way they're going to become a believer in Jesus Christ is for those scales to be removed from their eyes, and that takes the power of God. It's not my words. It's the power of God, and that's why we need Saturday prayers for Sunday power, so that when I open my mouth, it's the power of an almighty God. Only God can take the scales off the blind eyes. You know, we live in an area where people have heard the Bible over and over and over and over and over, right? Take your head, yes. Over and over and over and over. This is what the Bible says. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. Every time you hear the Bible, and every time you choose to walk out of that door and not bend the knee to Jesus Christ, or bend the knee and obey the Bible, your heart becomes harder. A little harder, a little harder, a little harder, a little harder. And I'm going to tell you, it's not my words, it's not my alliteration, it's not my illustrations, none of that breaks through those hardened hearts. Nothing. It is only the power of an almighty God. That is why I am saying to you, church, the body of Christ, you want to see results in the church service? Become a Saturday prayer for Sunday power. Take that tear off section in your bulletin. Say, Pastor, I will pray at such and such a time. Or, say, assign me a time. Or, become a pulpit prayer and pray once every 3 months as I'm preaching. It is only the presence of God and the power of God it's going to make a difference. Now, what are our connection points? There are three. Connection point number one is, are you 100% certain of your position in Jesus Christ? Are you? Because I'm going to tell you something. The Bible says in John 15, 16, and 19 that we are called out of the world, which means I have a different set of values. I have a different set of priorities. It means that I am choosing to bear fruit to the glory of God. Look at your life. Look at 2016. What were your values? What were your priorities? What was your purpose for existing? Is there fruit in your life? If you're not sure of your relationship with Jesus Christ, why would you walk out of this building without having come and take my hand and say, Pastor, I'm not sure. Get right, make sure before you leave today. That's our position. But I'm going to tell you something. This is from church history. And I know you all love this. Tacitus. Not Tacitus. Tacitus. Tacitus was a Roman senator. He lived between 58 and 117. And in the writings of Tacitus, we find the first non-Christian writings that talk about Christians. Do you know what the Roman senator Tacitus said about the believers in Jesus Christ? He said, quote, they were people who showed hatred of the human race. May I ask you, how have times changed from AD 117 to 2017? Turn on the news, and what is the problem with you and me as a believer in Jesus Christ? We're haters, right? We're haters. Nothing changed. You have to walk out of here knowing if you belong to Jesus. If you're different, if you're identified with Jesus, stand on the Bible. Be righteous, not religious. You're going to be hated. Finally. Hatred without a cause. Did you see that? Jesus said in verse 25, I am hated without a cause, without a reason. Think about that. There was no legitimate reason to hate Jesus. Hated without cause, hated without reason. I would humbly like to ask you this. Would you pray that if our church is hated, or hated without cause, or hated without reason, that the only cause or reason would be to stand with Jesus, or identify with Jesus? We believe the Bible. We teach the Bible. We're sinners. And we believe in righteousness, not religion. You have experienced, and I have experienced, the fact that some of the most mean-spirited people in all the world find Jesus as Savior. Is that right? It's true. So let's make sure that if our community hates us, it's not because we're haters. It's not because we're mean. It's because we stand with Jesus. And Jesus loves people. We're going to leave here in a moment. You have a choice to make. Your choice is to look back to 2016 and say, was there fruit? Are my values different? What was my priority? If you have doubts about 2016, maybe you should just come and take my hand and say, Pastor, I'm not sure I'm a Christian. Because I give no evidence of it. No fruit. But that's your choice to make. Because I can promise you that today, the Holy Spirit is calling you out of the world. I can tell you that the same Jesus who went to seek the man born blind, he's seeking you right now. And that Holy Spirit knocking at your heart's door. I remember going and visiting somebody a few years ago, and they said, I hate when you say 1 John 5:13 that we can know for certain we have eternal life. I said, I do. Well, I do it. They said, I hate when you did that knocking. I feel like God's beating my door down. time to accept Christ. They did. Right there in their living room floor, they accepted Christ. She and her husband. You know where they're at today? He's in the bars. They've got a divorce. I have no idea where he's at. You know why? Because they made bad choices. So I'm asking you to make the right choice. Choose Christ as Savior. And then they need to make this decision. Jesus has told us since John 13, some very important truths. He's told us how to be happy. He's told us how to live with purpose. He's told us how to live with prevailing prayer. He's told us how to have peace. And he's told us if we follow him, we're going to be persecuted. J. Vernon McGee said, quote, beware of the Christian who is popular with the world. J. Vernon McGee said, beware of a compromising position in order to be popular. So you see, I close my Bible, my bowl, down, you see him as invitation. Emily's going to sing for the offering. When you take up the offering, you get a few announcements and we're out of the door. You've got to make a choice. And my choice is, that's what Jesus said. Now, am I going to do it or am I not? And that's something that only you can do. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. And thank you for the gift of eternal life. Now, Father, it is now your time. And I'm going to ask as we stand and as we sing in just a moment, Lord, that we might pray as a Christian for those individuals who are uncertain of their salvation. Come to know Christ the Savior. And the Father, we might pray for ourselves. But instead of just coming and hearing a man yell, I might choose to be happy. I might choose to live with peace and purpose. And I'd rather be persecuted than be popular. The Lord, I'm going to ask you, right here, right now, to move in our hearts. We make decisions right now by the eternal significance in Jesus' name. Amen. Come just as you are. Hear the Spirit call. He's knocking at the door. Come. Hold. Wait. Pulpit prayer. I'll put those little tear-off sections in the offering. trouble. But others, Lord, I pray that your Spirit will so come down upon them that they will feel your weight upon them, that they will choose to do something about their relationship with you. Now, Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for this day. And thank you for dying on the cross for my sin and allowing me to have righteousness in Christ. In Jesus' name.